Everybody. I'm Tony. I'll be your instructor today. And we're here to talk about programming 3D applications in HTML5 and WebGL. A little bit about me. I'm based in San Francisco. I've been working in 3D on the web and virtual reality since it's been a category, about 20 years on and off. Originally with a technology called VRML, the first 3D standard for first standard for 3D in a web browser. Most recently, my career has turned toward WebGL, which is 3D built into your browser with no downloads, no hassle, and that's what we're going to talk about today primarily. But we're also going to talk about technologies related to that. I'm also the author of two O'Reilly books. The links are up here. I think they were also sent around in the package I sent to you. Did everyone get the package, by the way? The info, the setup? Did everyone do the setup steps that we have here? Does everyone get the GitHub repo? Everyone cloned it, ready to go?
It's taking forever.
Oh, you're doing it here? Good luck. Okay. That's fine. So we got some preambles. So you guys, while you're choking this tiny internet connection, if any of you can tether your phones, you might be better off, unless your data plans suck. I tend to do that a lot these days when I'm at these conferences. It's just I go phonal for things I really need. So I might suggest that, because 4G can be really good. Hey, how we doing? I'm not running screen capture in here. It kills my visuals. It just does not work with the real-time 3D stuff, so we got to rely on video for this. I mean, it works, but it kills frame rate. I tested that. I forgot to email you back about that, but yeah. So we're good to go. The crew's been great, and everybody's ready. Thank you, Ann. Ladies and gentlemen, that's Ann. She runs the conference. She's amazing. So I suggest trying to do that on your own connection if you can. Please make sure you're running a web server. You can't just use the examples that are supplied here, open them up from a Windows Explorer or your Finder file browser because of technical reasons. The HTML5 will open, you can see your page, but and you can see anything drawn in the canvas element, but if it needs to load outside resources like images, which are put on texture maps onto the surfaces of objects, cross-domain restrictions, cross-origin policy restrictions will forbid it from your file system. Either that, or you can throw that flag in your Chrome browser if you're using Chrome, which tells it to ignore those restrictions, and I don't remember what that flag is called. So, and I'm not sure that's a good thing to do, good practice to have custom flags in your browser that don't look like what your customers may be experiencing out in the field, and all of a sudden, before you know it, you're shipping broken software because your configuration on your computer's custom. So I would suggest instead get a web server running. So does everyone have a web server running on their local machine? Got your Apache or your Node.js, your Python Simple HTTP? Good. Once it's done and you've got all these files, and I know some of you are still fetching things, just grab everything in the tree and either put it in the doc root of your Apache server or put a sim link in if your doc root of your server, or put a sim link in if your server supports symbolic links, and then you can put it anywhere on your hard drive, but just throw it somewhere where you can get at it from localhost / whatever. Everybody got a text editor? We're going to do a few labs here and there where we're going to be actually doing hands-on code. And also, you probably just want that to be able to follow along easily. So view source is kind of limited. If you want to look at multiple files, it's better to have a project view in Eclipse or Sublime. For you who just arrived, there's a Wi-Fi code on the table next to the projector. Though the Wi-Fi blows here, and you may want to just tether. All right. Okay, Zach or Adam, we could kill the lights for about 2 minutes while we get into preamble here. See how dark we can go. I was hoping we could keep it there. Everyone ready? People are still fiddling, aren't you? Like, still downloading stuff? Maybe I should give you a few minutes. Can everyone work while we have the low light situation? Are we okay? I think so, right? All right. So, we live in a 3D world. People move, think, and experience in three dimensions, right? Our media, a lot of it these days, is actually 3D. The movies we watch, the video games we play. Even our broadcast news, at least whenever it comes to be election time, you know, how many of us have seen Wolf Blitzer walking around stupidly on a virtual set? Well, this has sort of become a mainstay in our broadcast vocabulary now that, you know, basically the production graphics that are behind our news are also 3D. Even though it's shown on a flat screen, you don't need an Oculus Rift to actually have that experience. And all that great graphical stuff has been built with high-end dedicated computers and expensive software over the years. That is, until now. So now we're in a situation where this phone has as much 3D computing power as the graphics workstation of a decade ago. And every computer and mobile tablet and phone ships with hardware acceleration for 3D. Even more importantly than that, the software to actually power the experiences in 3D is not only ubiquitously available, it's also free. And it's called a web browser. How many of you have seen the 100,000 Stars project from Google? Only a few of you. Good. Well, I'm going to show it to you. So this was created by Google's Data Arts Lab, their Chrome team responsible for showing off the cool capabilities of the Chrome browser. And what I'm doing is I'm taking a virtual fly-through of our Milky Way galaxy using a mouse in my web browser. As I roll over these labels, they get bigger. I click on them, and the Wikipedia entry comes up in an overlay and gives me all the information about that star. And I have a nice 3D rendering of that star. I can rotate around with the mouse, see the galactic plane in the background. I'll just take a little tour so I can talk while this thing does itself. So what are we seeing here? We're seeing high production value, real-time 3D graphics powered by WebGL. These overlays are just divs. They're part of your page content, just like the WebGL. They blend seamlessly together because the browser knows how to bring all these graphics together through a process called compositing. So your 2D and 3D can work seamlessly together. You can put 2D overlays on your 3D. You can embed 3D into 2D pages, vice versa, ad infinitum, to create a completely seamless integrated media presentation. What's more, the data that's powering this is all World Wide Web data. Everything's just fetched via URL. This experience could not be done in a browser 3 years ago. This experience is a CD-ROM of 10 years ago. It's a dedicated downloaded piece of software built by a large Hollywood production crew with, you know, encyclopedia content licensed from Britannica. I mean, that's what the world used to be like. Now, this is Wikipedia data, literally scraped based on the names of the stars, positional data taken from another database. And the visualization part was the hard work here, and it was done by a small team over the course of a month or two, combining WebGL and CSS3 together into this seamless and amazing presentation. And that's what we can do today with the technologies available in our browser. And that's what today's about. So welcome, and I hope we have fun today, and I hope it's interactive. Feel free to interrupt at any point. Questions, we're going to have labs. Point of logistics, lunch at 12:30-ish, but we're not sure exactly when yet. The conference people will come and tell us. Bathrooms are way the heck over there and hard to find, but if you're looking and you don't know, just go that way as far as you can. I found that out earlier. And there we are. Welcome to my course. And let's get going. We can bring the lights up, guys. Well, let me kill that sound. Beautiful, but tedious. Okay, so how is this possible? Well, it starts with HTML5. It's a new visual medium that contains three technologies that we're going to be talking about today, primarily. And that's WebGL to accelerate your graphics. So the graphics processor in here and here both talk through a software and device driver layer called OpenGL. WebGL makes that accessible to JavaScript programmers. That's it, period, full stop. Details are interesting, scary sometimes, and what we're going to go over a lot today, but it's nothing more and nothing less than being able to write a real-time 3D application that takes full advantage of the hardware in good old JavaScript. We also have CSS3, so your page elements can actually be, those are your 2D page elements, can be morphed and transformed using 3D transforms, making for very interesting user interface effects, and we're going to talk about those in one specific section and probably early afternoon, maybe this morning if we go fast enough. And combined, you can actually bring those two things together to create very interesting integrated presentations like we saw in 100,000 stars. And then there's the Canvas API, which is a 2D API for drawing your graphics. But if you're in a situation where you can't use WebGL to draw your 3D, you can actually draw Canvas-based 3D and do some emulation there. We actually may have time to go through all this today. We'll see. I'm leaving that for last only because it's essentially a fallback situation when it comes to Canvas drawing. And then the browser itself puts these all together into a seamless presentation called, you know, through a process called compositing. So it just all looks like one screen for your user, and that's the way it should. The other thing that's key here is that the modern web browser has come a long way. The browser is now an application platform. The JavaScript VM has gotten screamingly fast, especially Chrome's, but everybody else's VM is pretty good. We talked about compositing. That's done at the hardware level, so all of your elements are drawn, blended, Z-ordered, done right, and you get a chance to get in there and actually draw at the same time the browser's doing its drawing, because we have this technology called request animation frame, so the browser will tell us when it's time to draw, and so things will look seamless and flicker-free. There's all these ancillary technologies that come with a browser now if you want to build a multiplayer game, data visualization, real-time streaming information using WebGL. You can use web workers, sockets, WebRTC, local storage and local databases to store things. So, I mean, you can really build what only could be a desktop application in the past. And if you're unlike me and you happen to be a JavaScript hater, and there are some not in the room necessarily, but at the conference and you know, a lot of people doing modern web development that JavaScript is just too annoying for them and they want a real programming language. Well, some of these languages have come out and become pretty interesting, like Dart from Google, TypeScript from Microsoft, asm.js, which is a low-level assembly language, JavaScript. Have people heard of that one? Yeah, so people are doing WebGL hacks now where they're taking whole game engines from C++ and converting them over using mscript into cross-compile it to this low-level JavaScript, making a very fat to download piece of JavaScript that's impossible to debug, but at the end result of that is you get a full 60 frames a second game in your browser that looks like this. This is a screenshot from a promotion piece, sort of marketing piece that Epic Games did with Mozilla last year called Epic Citadel. They just took it down because Epic's about to release a new version of their engine, and I think they didn't want the old one kicking around, but it was up for a long time. And you can get a 60 frames a second graphics that look like that and go through a pretty large game level. And it's beautiful in your web browser. The initial download is probably 2, 3, 4 minutes. So it's not your typical, you know, web performance thing. You go to the Velocity conference or you hear Steve Suter's talk at something. I don't know if he's here at this conference or not. I think he was. And, you know, web page performance is about, hey, the page has got to load in 2 seconds. The whole page, everything, not just your game, your UI, the whole bit. This was 2, 3, 4 minutes to get to that. So, you know, not your typical web page. People will wait for that for a game. And they may be the first level of a game and continue to stream. So that technology, unique and specific to maybe gaming or very high-end applications. But you can still get incredible results in your browser with all these platform technologies put together.
What is the host name or the URL of that?
See, the problem is I would search for Epic Citadel on YouTube at this point, because they took down the live demo. So I can get you the URL of the old live demo, but all you can really see now, and it doesn't work, all you can see now is Unreal Citadel, Epic Citadel. So go on YouTube and you're gonna see videos of it. And so for Game Developers Conference a few months ago here in town, they premiered Unreal Engine 4. This was 3 based. They premiered Unreal Engine 4, showed a whole new set of demos, videos. Nothing's live right now, so I don't know, they're still baking it. And demo stuff. But if you see it, it's really impressive. And I've seen this live and in the flesh, and it really works, and it's mind-blowing. So this is all great. Now, how real is it? Like, what browsers does it run in, and so on? Let's talk about that real quickly. People have already asked me that this morning. So all your desktop browsers support WebGL. Microsoft was a holdout on WebGL for a few years as it was becoming popular. Folks were worried about their lack of support for it. Microsoft people were claiming security issues and other things. The reality of those being whatever they are, Microsoft did an about face last summer, and they've been catching up and implementing support in Internet Explorer, and it's pretty good. And I have it from people at Microsoft, you know, vague numbers, but they're about 95% passing the conformance test that the WebGL teams have put together that all the browsers try and pass. I don't think anybody has 100% conformance, and that means doing every feature exactly like the spec says on everything. Even Chrome's maybe 99% conformant, though they have been trying to get to 100%. But for all intents and purposes, and for most things we do here, if we're not pushing the extreme envelope of everything about WebGL, not only do all the browsers support it on the desktop, it works exactly the same way on all those implementations. The story of the WebGL mobile has gotten pretty darn good. It's everywhere on Android. All the newer versions of Android and the newer devices support it in their mobile browsers. Kindle Fire HDX, which is Amazon's newer Kindle Fire line. I might have one in my bag. I'll dig it out later when we talk about mobile. This little 7-inch thing costs $229, does 60 frames a second WebGL. You just hit URLs just like you would on the web. You don't even have to bake an application or anything. It just works. Amazing. These other OSs like BlackBerry Tiz and Firefox all have WebGL support. Windows Surface, the newer ones have it. And then for iOS, it's kind of interesting. So we may hear some news in early June. There's a WebGL session apparently at Apple's WWDC on June 11th or 4th or whenever that week is. And maybe they're going to start supporting it in Mobile Safari. They haven't to date. And so what you do is you take some native libraries, sort of like PhoneGap, if you've done mobile HTML5 development. You take some native libraries from a company called Lude. They were showing at the exhibit yesterday. And they give you a way to implement WebGL in your HTML5 app and create an iOS app. They even have a cloud-based builder. So if you're not an iOS person and just want your HTML5 to start working in iOS, they'll bake one for you. They'll make a build for you. In the cloud, you get it back, you just put your developer creds on it and submit it to the store. And we're going to talk about that this afternoon in the last session. CSS3 is everywhere. All the browsers support it. It came out of Apple, so it's supported really well in iOS. So when we get to that section, you don't need to worry. Anything you write there is going to run everywhere. And same with the canvas. So if you end up wanting to build something in 3D, especially if you use the 3.js library, which we're going to talk about for the majority of the day, it has a canvas renderer, which does a pretty darn good job of most of this stuff. All right, so we're going to spend the rest of sort of section one here on just a primer, 3D graphics. Is there anybody has done 3D graphics programming in the past at some level? Okay, just a few of you, so good. I'm glad I got this primer section in here. And please, this is a place where, stop me if there's anything conceptual that doesn't make sense. And we're not going to cover the entirety of 3D graphics, just enough of the basics so we can understand. We can take our current knowledge of web development, maybe we've done animation or 2D stuff or SVG, we can bring that forward into this new world with a few other concepts under our belt. Well, let's start with a definition. I'm going to read this verbatim and then we're going to decompose it, okay? It's right out of Wikipedia. 3D computer graphics, in contrast to 2D computer graphics. By the way, can you see that stuff or is it too washed out? Should we go to low lights? Can you guys handle it? If we go dark, you're going to fall asleep? What?
Get scared.
You get scared? Okay. we'll protect you. The only other light setting is dark. We tried to go in the middle here, but maybe we can get some help from somebody on that later. Please, because people can't see this stuff. And I looked at it just now. I was going to read off the main screen, but I couldn't. And then I realized, if I can't see it, right? So, better, right? 3D computer graphics, in contrast to 2D computer graphics, are graphics that use a three-dimensional representation of geometric data, often Cartesian. For us today, we'll all be Cartesian, that is stored in the computer for the purposes of performing calculations and rendering 2D images. Such images may be stored for viewing later or displayed in real time. So the three keys to this definition are in italics. The first is that we are dealing conceptually with a three-dimensional representation of the data, of the scenes, of the content we want to present. So that would be, say, something that looked like this room, or a model of a car, or the visualization we saw of outer space with stars, spatially organized next to each other, having different, magnitude. So that's key to the whole thing, is that we have a model in our head of things with a third dimension. But what's also key is that 3D graphics is all about taking that information and then projecting it onto a flat plane so you can see it. Again, most of these things are rendered right now. We're going to talk about immersive hardware in a second. Onto a flat screen like this, a screen in my desktop computer, my TV screen for my console games, the tablet. Even with a stereo rendering device like the Oculus or these new virtual reality systems, you're actually just rendering two flat stereo images from a slightly different camera perspective and then blending them together to trick the eye at 60 frames a second, which is the third key to this whole thing. If it was just a nice 3D rendering and it didn't move on the screen somehow, either in response to you clicking or dragging or wasn't animating, then we could just do a still render and we wouldn't all be here today. What we're talking about is interactive 3D graphics that move in real time. So we need to be talking about technologies like hardware acceleration, fast JavaScript, and all the other things that support building an application that responds to the user's whims in real time. So these 3D graphics live in a 3D coordinate system. We know our 2D coordinate systems from web development, Windows development, right? X-axis goes this way, Y-axis goes this way. Historically, 3D y-axes tend to go up, which is the opposite of what we all know from our Windows systems and our web browsers, where positive y goes downward. This is an adjustment you might have to make if you're really sort of wedded to the other idea or just that's the way your brain thinks. So this is part of the history of 3D graphics. Not every 3D graphic system does it this way, but most tend to model their y coordinates up. So try not to get too tripped up by that if you're used to things going in the other direction. But most importantly, there's a third coordinate, which is Z. And that one's coming out of the screen toward your eye and going back into the screen away from your eye. And plus Z goes toward you in this convention. And there are systems that do both. But in general, OpenGL, WebGL-based systems tend to want to stick positive Y toward you. To actually get shapes on the screen in this 3D coordinate system, we tend to think a lot about 3D meshes. A mesh, think of as the surface, the outer part of what you see of any 3D object. So the mesh here in this face is this outer skin. And this outer skin is described by a bunch of quadrangles, these four-sided polygons. And those four-sided polygons are composed of vertices, 3D vertices with X, Y, Z positions. All good? Straightforward? Everyone know vertex? X, Y, Z triple? Polygon composed of three or four of those typically. Most rendering systems work in triangles. This one happens to be quads. It was a nice picture I got off Wikipedia. And then those things are put together to create the outer surface of something that's rendered on the screen as a 3D shape.
Quick question.
Yeah.
Why most 3D render works in triangles?
Instead of, say, voxels, which is what you might think of, right? There's pixels, and then there's 3D pixels, which are called voxels, right? Which is what Minecraft is made of, for example, right? That's a good question. There's a long history there that started in, I think, you know, in efficient representation for software-based rendering systems going back to the 1960s. I mean, really long. This is old. This stuff is old. This has been around for 50 years already, 3D graphics at some level. And as the generations of hardware started coming out that did 3D, they also followed this same paradigm of being able to rapidly represent these triangles, rapidly compute these triangles to represent the surface of an object. I mean, if you think about it, these outer shape, I mean, you're mostly seeing the outer shape of something, right? We're not seeing what's inside it. I mean, this isn't about, say, you know, rendering every pixel that's behind the you know, inside that person's head, right? That doesn't need to be dealt with or computed. So I think there's a lot of that sort of mathematical efficiency and history to it. Just the way it is. So, and it's like 2D drawing. I mean, 2D drawing uses polygons too, actually. I mean, it uses pixels as well, but canvas drawing is mostly about creating polygonal shapes for your texts, your paths, your rectangles, whatever. So, good question. I wish I had a better answer, but it's the way it's always been done. So, the vertices that compose the shape of an object are a great way to represent that shape. Now, what if you want to move that shape around on the screen? You could change every vertex position and redraw it. Or you could use something called a transform. If people use the 2D transforms either in Canvas API or in CSS, right? Some basic idea is this. I've got, you know, a set of data that's the vertices to represent this cup. If I want to move this cup around on the screen, I could go through and change every vertex position on it and redraw it. Or instead, what I can do is I can change a much smaller data structure, a transform matrix, which has got X, Y, Z positions. In 3D, it's got rotational data. It can have scaling, right? I can change that matrix, and that matrix, then, those values will be applied to multiply every vertex position, but that's done by the renderer. So it's a much more efficient way of dealing with moving stuff around. So in this example here, I got my cube. It's showing up, three different instances of that cube showing up, right? But I didn't actually change the vertices, I just changed the translation, moved it around. I changed the rotation and moved it around. I only created the data for that cube once. It's just those vertices there, the eight of them, and the, you know, face descriptions for the six faces. And then, you know, the gritty details of this is matrix math. It's a 4x4 matrix, so you can do your 3D math. And I don't know if people care about those details. We can bust into those later. But those mathematical bits in there are used to multiply the 3D vectors to create the resulting final transform. So you see it on the screen. Clear so far? I mean, we're going to be using these things in practice when we go to the next section. So I want to make sure there's nothing mysterious yet. And I think this is all pretty straightforward. All right, then finally, again, all this stuff's got to get rendered onto a screen. So you've got your wonderful 3D representation, your matrix math has figured out where the cube's going to go, but the thing still has to get drawn, right? So in your mind, it looks like this. In the computer, it's sort of got data that looks like this, but it's got to get drawn onto that green plane. And the way that's done is through projection. Most 3D graphics we're going to build are perspective viewed. So just like in the real world, when you have perspective, as things are farther away, they get smaller. We have the same idea here. So imagine the camera, which is the virtual entity in your simulation, or your eye point being here. You know, we need to be able to draw the scene such that these cubes show up in the right place on that plane. And that's done by creating a special kind of matrix called a projection matrix and multiplying everything in the scene by that to get it onto a flat 2D plane. We don't need to know how to do those details. We're going to go through them real quick when we cover raw WebGL in our first section, just so you get a flavor for it. But thankfully, it's pretty weird math, and I'm going to be the first to admit I'm not the biggest math geek, and I hate this part of 3D graphics. I like the pictures on the screen, but I hate doing the math. So we have a library that does it for us, which is great, but you want to know what's going on under the covers. It's this. So in WebGL, WebGL is really ultimately a 2D drawing API. It's just one that uses 3D hardware to do all this fancy math for us fast and get that thing projected on the screen, and we're going to see what that means in a moment. But this is what's going on under the covers. And then finally, the thing we need to do after, besides this, in order to get pixels drawn on the screen, is we need to create a programmable shader. This is interesting. This is a real departure from anything we've done in web development. We use a different programming language called GLSL, GL shading language. What that is a C-like programming language, which is compiled by the graphics card and loaded onto the graphics card and executed for every vertex in your vertex data that's going to be drawn, and every pixel on the screen to paint the colors of those vertices. So that projection takes your 3D data, turns it into screen space 2D vertex data via something called a vertex shader, and then using its companion, the fragment shader, which we're going to see in a moment, the pixels get painted for those vertices. So you have to do that to do WebGL coding. But again, thankfully, someone's built libraries that's got a lot of this stuff out of the box for us. But we're going to see what it looks like for real in practice in a moment. But, you know, that's kind of a drag. It's kind of a hassle. But what it allows you to do is some amazing stuff like this. If I can find it. I don't think I have it in my... There we go. It's in my history, though. Yes, Wi-Fi. This is all about the Wi-Fi, not about this page taking a long time to load, because usually it takes a tenth of a second. So if you'll bear with me. Come on. You guys weren't kidding. That's some bad Wi-Fi. You know, I might have to tether too. Yeah, seriously, guys, slight pause while I tether. This is ridiculous. What's that? It's brilliant.
Yeah.
That's a great way to do. Thank you for cooperating on that.
Can somebody have all the video numbers?
Can we just bring the lights up? These guys can do some. They can do some sneaker net and pass this stuff around while I'm tethering, so we can get this example up. Thanks, Adam. Appreciate it. Sorry to break the theatrical bubble we were in, but it was time anyway. I was just going to ask to put the lights on a minute later anyway. This is ridiculous. All right. All right, me try tether. So we got that going? We have multiple ones of that where people can do a little sneaker net share so everyone can get the code? We're going to need it soon. Yeah, all you need is the Git repo. If someone's got a copy, put it on a hard drive, that would be awesome. Or multiple ones if you got it. What? Oh, AirDrop can work too. That's a good idea. We're doing whatever we can here. See how it, look at that. See that? That's my iPhone. Thank you, Apple. The wonders of 4G. All right, we can leave the lights up for now. I think, can people see this well enough? Yeah. All right. If we get to a point where you want the lights down again, just so we can see some of the graphics, then we'll do that. Let me know. All right. Well, this is cool. Look at these wonderful effects. I'm actually dragging the mouse and creating ripples. I can take this object, move it around with my mouse. If I click outside of it, yeah, what's the? Press spacebar to pause and unpause. What? Let me see. There's something. I can make the ball bounce. Gee, toggle gravity. Here comes the ball. Look at this. Okay, so that's pretty cool, guys. And just remember, this is running in a web browser. Just in case we forgot, let's just reset, right? So these scary things called shaders that we have to deal with to write a program to just get a pixel on the screen, I mean, WTF, why do I have to do that? But here's the point. If you make the commitment to learn this stuff, at some point you want to get into serious special effects in your web pages. Every web browser on the planet lets you write code to do stuff like this now. Just think about that for a second.
How far back in browser history can you go with this stuff?
What do you mean?
Internet Explorer 10, 9?
IE 11, they're the laggard, right. So depends on what you're trying to do. So we're going to talk about some techniques for detecting whether or not the browser supports WebGL, how to fall back, what you might do in that situation. Yeah, that's really astute, yeah. So I'm painting a really rosy picture of this, but the fact is it's sort of, okay, there's not a good way to measure this definitively in terms of adoption of desktop browsers, but here's a data point. You guys know about this NORAD Santa tracker?
Yes.
So NORAD tracks Santa's progress around the globe every year at Christmas time, all right? Well, that Santa tracker for the last 2 or 3 years has included something by the people who built it, which is a WebGL visualization of Santa. And 90% of their audience last year were able to get into that WebGL tracker. And that was something like 40 million people worldwide. So that's pretty good. And it's grown 40% every year over year for 3 years since they've been doing it. Again, that's one data point. Pretty damn good one. Because that's real people checking out real Santa Claus.
Ooh. Rendering to this texture is not supported. When did that happen? That's cool. See? And someone wrote some robust code. See that little error catch right there? I don't know what that's all about. But there are ways to figure out if something's in trouble. All right. Back to it. That's it for section one. So that's the intro. So any questions on the basics of 3D graphics, coordinate systems, meshes, transforms, viewport projections? That's probably the trickiest one of the whole mess because don't have to ever think about that in 2D. A mesh is just a shape. So imagine you wanted to make a model of this cup out of chicken wire, right? And you made just a smooth surface like this and connected another piece of wire on the bottom, right? Everything you see there would be either quads or triangles, depending on how the wire was made, or hexes. But those are the polygons. Those shapes that the wire makes are the polygons that represent the surface of an object. So those then will have materials, textures, and shading put on them to create the surface. So those polygons, can be drawn in wireframe, but they're usually not rendered that way. What you do is then color the pixels on each polygon based on other inputs, you know, texture maps, bitmaps, light sources, and shade. That's where shading comes into play and shaders come into play, and we're going to see how that's done in a moment. But that is the idea, right? So it's like very similar to drawing a filled shape in Canvas, if you've been doing that, where you draw a Bezier curve and say, you know, fill it. Yes, matrix slide.
I see there that you have the last row is like on gray and the other is normal. So when you do the translation, with the data for translation is only those three?
Yeah, this is linear algebra, which, see, I shouldn't be afraid of this stuff. I actually got an A+ on my final, but it was 25 years ago, so like, I don't remember any of this stuff. But 3D vectors are multiplied by this 4D matrix. The scale values are along the diagonal, right? So your X, Y, and Z scales along the diagonal. This is what's called a homogeneous coordinate. You can do skewed projections if you mess with this one, but this is almost always set to one in the stuff we're going to get into. And I'd have to go back and remember the rest of the math and why you do it. So you multiply your scale values by these in X, Y, and Z. You add these to the position, and the rotations are actually contained in here and here. And I forgot how those are actually computed. We'd have to go look at the math for it. So what was the specific question?
The last row.
Oh, in the bottom? I don't think it's used. It's kind of a waste. I don't think it's used for the math we do. But I have to go back and look. Sorry, to crack my own 3D books open for that. All right. And this one, again, you can mostly take it on faith, but we're going to just see it in a moment because we're going to look at how WebGL does this and then probably move on and never come back to it. All right. Oh, yeah, so you know we can self-direct this a little bit. One of the things I have for this program is this mostly follows my new book, which is 12 chapters on all this stuff. I combined a lot of the later chapters into essentially workshops at the end of the day. But one thing I completely skipped in the syllabus is rendering using 2D canvas, so you can do a fallback and emulation of your 3D. If you guys really want to cover that, we can find a spot for about 15 or 20 minutes and try and breeze through it, okay? But you just let me know a few sessions into this if you really care about this canvas fallback, and I'll actually do it just, you know, swarm style, like if, you know, if more than half of you want to deal with it, we'll get into it kind of thing, or a significant portion of you want to deal with it. So I just had to remember that because I give this course a lot, and I have a longer version of it that would take longer than a day. All right, you guys ready to talk about WebGL? We can leave the lights up for this because there's no interesting graphics in this section, Adam. All right. So again, this is our real-time rendering technology in the browser. This is what gives us access to the OpenGL rendering pipeline that talks to the hardware on every phone, tablet, desktop computer on the planet. Back in 2006, a guy named Vlad Vukasevich working at Mozilla wanted to start experimenting with 3D rendering in a canvas, and he created a technology called Canvas 3D. There was already a 2D canvas that had started in about 2004, which was being pushed by Apple at the time, and so people were thinking a lot about this idea of, okay, it's time to move past just this fixed set of DOM elements and trying to coax everything with corner radiuses and all those stupid hacks you got to do, you know, when you wanted to draw a shape. Can we give people drawing technology in a browser? So 2D Canvas was the first attempt at doing that. And Vlad said, well, you know, we got 3D hardware everywhere. Maybe we can do a 3D Canvas. They joined up with Opera, Apple, Google, some hardware vendors doing OpenGL, and the Cronus Consortium, which is a software-hardware consortium of vendors doing accelerated technology for mobile browsers and all that, and decided to base this on OpenGL. And they decided to do this very low-level approach to graphics programming. How many people have done any OpenGL programming, either on desktop or mobile? Anybody here? A little bit. You've tinkered, right? So if you've looked at the API, and we're going to see in a second, it's horrifying. It's terrifying for us normal web devs, in my opinion. But the point was, this is the way you were already doing your accelerated 3D graphics on your phone and on set-top boxes. So they had a well-understood API, and they said, why don't we get that into a web browser? Maybe that way we'll have some 3D in the browser and we'll figure out how to deal with the API issues later, but at least it will be working. We know this API. We already have 20, 30, 40 hardware vendors and software people who agree on this. It's a standard. Let's just get it into JavaScript. And so that's what they did. So you go to chronos.org and you look up WebGL, you learn more than you'd ever want to know about that standard, which is this. And we're going to decompose this definition too. It's an API. As I mentioned, you're drawing just like you draw with Canvas. There are no 3D DOM elements. No 3D DOM elements yet. I just did a talk on this yesterday at the conference. So there's basically no representation of your 3D data stored in the browser. You draw it. You store it yourself in your JavaScript. It's based on OpenGL, the standard I've been talking about. Runs on your phone, runs on your desktop. That's how you build your native mobile applications and desktop applications. Here's one key to WebGL, why I think it's taking over the world, why I think it's so amazing personally, is your WebGL content combines with everything else in your page because the browser composites. If you ever built a Flash-based app where you wanted to have an overlay user interface, you guys done Flash development? Yeah. So you ever try and do an overlay with browser stuff on top of it, then you got to go to W mode transparent and all that other nonsense, your performance goes to hell, right? That's the best it gets, you know. Worse than that, most people don't turn that flag on, and you have to have, you can't combine your UI and your rendering window. You just can't do it, right? Same with Unity 3D. If you've built a 3D app in Unity and they have that web player plugin, you get that in there. You can't do your user interface in HTML if you wanted to appear over your 3D content. So in the case of Unity, what you would do is you get some add-ins from the Unity store that do a 2D user interface in some clunky way, and it's not HTML. You got to use some other syntax. It doesn't use CSS. You can't style it to make it look like the rest of your page content. You know, FML. So not great. But now we're in a situation where you can do all that and put these overlays together. And so to me, this is the sleeping tiger of WebGL. It's built for dynamic web applications. The texture maps that you put on the surface of your objects are just images. Not only can those be mapped onto the surface of an object, the 2D canvas you draw can. So you could dynamically draw your texture maps using Canvas API. A video element can be put on the texture of a surface. So you could build a virtual scene that has movies playing on a TV in the scene, for example. And that's a prosaic and one of the simplest cases, but you can do really cool stuff that way. It's also got a security model that comes along with all the challenges of doing dynamic web applications and injected content, and they've thought about this very carefully. So that's why you have these cross-origin restrictions on textures and everything else. Cross-platform runs everywhere and royalty-free, because it's got to be, because it's a web technology. As I mentioned, it's an API. Just like when you're drawing into Canvas, you get a context. Instead of saying context, you know, canvas element.getContextQuote2D, you say getContextWebGL. It's nowhere near as friendly a drawing API as the Canvas is if you've drawn on Canvas. We're going to see that in a moment. It does accelerate, and people use this to draw 2D as well as 3D graphics. Really, ultimately, again, it's just about getting pixels on the screen. And we're seeing a lot of people use WebGL to do fast Canvas gaming, like, you know, Canvas style. They're using the 3D drawing to get the acceleration in the pipeline, but they're doing a side-scroller game that could be done with a 2D Canvas API. They're just getting, you know, 30, 40% faster performance by using WebGL as the drawing layer. Our focus today is on 3D stuff, but just as an aside and just so you know, you can build a great 2D or 2.5D game or a presentation using WebGL because you'll get better, beautifuler, faster graphics.
So do you think that's going to phase out a lot of Canvas work?
You know, I don't know if it is, only because it, as we're going to see, requires some toolkits on top of it to make it comprehensible. We're about to get into what it takes to draw in WebGL, and you're just going to see that you got to do a lot of stuff if you go to the metal with WebGL to just put a shape on the screen. So unless you're ready to build your own engine that does that, and some people will be, and you know, people developing games are often not only willing to do that but eager and happy because they like to hack engines, then it will make sense to do that. Or you get a really good 2D API drawing kit that under the covers is drawing WebGL and doing it fast for you. You know, some game engine that already exists like that. And there's, you know, people doing projects like this, a lot of them open source. You know. So I don't think it's going to, you'll see it disappear, but for sure the performance and graphics you get out of this are going to make WebGL an enticing alternative, especially when they turn it on in mobile Safari and it runs well. And if that happens soon, that we might see more of that. I've beaten this to death already. The way that WebGL integrates with your page is amazing. And just as a reminder, there is no file format here. You can't say, can I load a Wavefront OBJ file, very common 3D modeling format. Can I load a 3D Studio Max file into my browser and will WebGL render that for me? No, it won't. WebGL won't render any files for you. You do that yourself. You build a file loader for a particular file format syntax decode it in JavaScript, and do the magic to get it on the screen via all the techniques we're going to talk about today. As I mentioned, there's also not only no way to store that data, there's no markup language equivalent of it either. There's no SVG or anything like that yet for doing 3D content, though I'm working on a project like that. Like I said, I presented it yesterday at a talk at the conference. No DOM API. So you're in your own API land. You can either use WebGLs or build a toolkit on top or use one of the many that we're going to talk about today to do it for you, but you're not doing DOM programming other than I got a canvas element by doing get document.getElement by ID. Here's my canvas. I get a 2D or a 3D context, rather, from it. At that point, it's whatever API is out there that I'm happy with or I built myself. You get no more help from the browser on it, as I've just been saying. So best thing you can do is then go find one of these great libraries out there and get started with it. So let's take a walk through the anatomy of a WebGL application. First thing you got to do is you got to create a canvas element, either through a tag in the page or document.createElement. Then you get that context, quote, WebGL. Then you initialize a viewport. Remember we talked about that projection? Well, we need to tell WebGL what rectangle that viewport is. In other words, what subset of the canvas we're going to draw to. For a lot of you, you're probably just going to say 0, 0, canvas.width, canvas.height. You can draw to the whole thing, but you could make multiple viewports and draw to them separately within a single canvas if you wanted to do four different views of the same object or something. Then it gets interesting. Then you create something called a buffer, which is a pile of data. You create some of these matrices we're going to need to do 3D transformations, so to move objects around, but then the 2D to 3D projection, 3D to 2D projection as well. Got to create at least one shader, or you won't see any pixels on the screen. Initialize the shaders, a lot of setup. Finally, you draw, and the draw is basically, I've set up a bucket of data. I'm calling that a buffer. We're going to look at that in a second. Now, after all that setup's done, during my render loop, which I'm going to do continuously, especially if it's animated, I'm going to draw. And so we're going to look at how we build this cube, which is going to be a cube with the WebGL logo mapped onto each face. Okay? And if you don't know about this site, I actually run this site. Someone else created it a couple years ago, several years ago, and about a year ago, he got too busy to run it anymore. He's a Python guy, and he's like, I can't do WebGL my nights anymore because I've got a startup. Does someone want to take it over? And I said, hey, right here, I love WebGL. So, you know, we get something like 20,000 people traipsing through this site every month to learn about this. They are learning about not what I'm going to teach you today, but low-level WebGL from the ground up. And so this particular segment is inspired by these lessons and adapted from. So if you guys, everyone got the sources now? Yeah, I know? We good? So, you know, go to the folder chapter 2 and look at example 2-3. You can browse it at your leisure, but we'll take a look at it and then we'll view some source on it. Okay, so there it is. So tumble is a request animation, frame-driven animation that's just moving a rotation value around continually. We'll look at that. We see the texture map on the faces of a 3D cube. So how did we do it? The font size good? Can everybody see it? Big enough? And you got it in front of you? All right, so we'll start with main here. Where is it? Here we go. And our document ready. That's at the bottom. What are we going to do? We had already defined an element somewhere. Where is it? Right here. We define a canvas element using a tag. I put some inline style in there. I think I was experimenting with borders to see if I could see my canvas. And I got a 500 by 500 canvas element. All right, so I get that, and then I do stuff to it. I'm going to call a function called initWebGL to try and get the WebGL drawing context for me. If that throws up, I'm going to get an alert that says my browser doesn't support it. And we're going to look at that in a second. Then I'm going to create that viewport, set up the matrices, create the data for the cube, which is going to create buffers, initialize the shaders, initialize the texture map. That takes a little bit of work, too. It's just image data from a web perspective, but you've got to tell WebGL a few things about it. And then we call run, which is a request animation frame run loop. Has everyone worked with request animation frame? Do people know what that is? All right, we're going to labor details on that in our section on animation a little bit later this morning, hopefully. But the essence of it is this is what you tell the browser. This is a function you tell the browser to call every time it's ready to draw the page. And this is the preferred technique to doing it over set timeout. You don't do set timeouts to do your animation anymore. So this bit here is something that's a method in the browser, and you pass it a function and say, call me every time you're going to draw. So we'll get more into detail about that later, but that's what's driving the cube tumbling around on the screen. And that says draw, which is where the real work happens to draw that cube, and then it just calls itself again, basically. Oh, no. This, and then it just moves the data around a little bit, which is the animate function. We'll look at that last. And the magic to get this recalled next time through is that. So you pass a function into the browser, and it calls it again with that run with those parameters. So let's look. Let's start by getting the context. Let's go all the way to the top. Now we're going to go top down here. Let's see. Do I have some of this in slides? A little prettier? Yep. But you can follow on your screen. All right. The first thing we're going to do is I'm getting ready to have a message to Yak just in case we didn't find anything. And then we put things in a try block and we say this. So that's how we get our 3D drawing context. Now, a couple things could happen. Three things could happen. This could come back with a valid WebGL context. It could generate an exception, which is why we have a catch block here. And then we'll tell you what happened. But this can also come back null. That seems to be a bit browser dependent. So trying to catch all these cases. If we fall through to here, we didn't do the catch. We just check on GL and just say blah. Now, you didn't necessarily want to do that to build a nice responsive web application. Your error handling could do something different, like try to do a canvas-based render, go to another page that's all CSS, or just say your browser sucks, go get new Chrome. I mean, there's a lot of different ways to do it, and that is up to you building your application. So assuming we succeeded at this, we get back a valid 3D drawing context that we can draw into with WebGL. We're off to the races. The next thing we need to do with that, as we've seen, is initialize the viewport. This is a method of that drawing context object. Now we're getting into the details of the WebGL API. GL.viewport. Left, top, size, width, and height. We're going to use the whole canvas to draw into. As I mentioned, you could just draw into a little rectangle on the canvas and use the rest of the canvas for something else. You could draw to a bunch of these with separate GL methods on that canvas. All right, so that's all kind of straightforward, but this is where we start kind of falling off a cliff onto new information and stuff that, I don't know. It's different than anything I ever did for web development. It's very similar to a lot of stuff I've done in 3D development, but most of us are web devs, so we got to explore this new world. We call a method to create something called a buffer. A buffer is very generic in WebGL. It can hold all kinds of data that can be used for all kinds of stuff. In this case, we're going to use that buffer, which we're saying is going to be array data. We're going to use that now. WebGL is sort of like a state machine. So every method you call is operating on the current thing, right? So what we're saying here is the array buffer that's built into GL state machine is going to fill the context of this object vertex buffer, which we just created. And we're going to do that later by stuffing data into it. All right. What's the data we stuff into it? Well, this is a cube, so we're going to create the data for a cube. These are all the vertices that go into making a cube, right? The coordinate position. So -1, -1, 1.0, that's x, y, z. So down here, right, because it's, well, it's -1, yeah. I'm going to do it from your point of view, right? So -1x is over here, if this is the origin. -1x, -1y, and 1z, so out of the screen. So we get the 8 corners that we need as vertices to create the cube. Each one of these is the 4 vertices for the face of a cube. So there we go. That's a quad. It's a, you know, 4-element polygon. We're going to do that for the 6 faces. So I didn't put all the details here, but you can see them. Question?
Is the origin at the center of the canvas?
The origin is at the center of your virtual world in your head, the conceptual world, right? In your XYZ coordinate system, okay. Right? That's the origin. That gets drawn on the canvas anywhere, depending on how you render this, right? That gets to how you do the projection. Okay. You could project this and make the origin not be there. Or you could conceptually have the origin of the world be rendered right at the center of the canvas, but maybe you're playing with the viewport and letting people pan through things. So, you know, you got to think of them as separate in your head, right? But typically, you viewing this for most applications, what you're looking at least you know, when you'd start up, if you were looking at the center of the world, the origin would be at the center of your canvas, but not necessarily, too, because you may be looking at something from a point of view somewhere in the middle of a world that's when you're on a traveling camera and it's moving around all the time. So can't think of it that way. It's a good question, and it shows how complicated this stuff is. All right, well, so all this is just a JavaScript array of numbers at this point. It's got to get fed to WebGL. So the way we do that is we take that verts, that's this guy, we create something called a float 32 array. That's a typed array. Have you heard of those? This is brand new stuff introduced into browsers, largely driven by the need for this in WebGL, though these constructs are being used in a lot of different applications today. It's binary data that represents numbers. It can either be floats or integers. And it's represented packed the way the machine would represent them internally. So if you build, if you ever built a C++ application for native or Objective-C, and you just make an array of 32-bit floats or an array of integers, it's nice and tight. It's tightly packed, right? A lot more so than an array of JavaScript variables, each of which, I mean, these things in the JavaScript VM, that can be a number, that can be a piece of text, that can be an object. So every JavaScript variable is represented with extra data in it to tell you what type it is and all this other stuff. So this is fat, it's slow, and it's not good. Like, if you're doing a model of a, you know, a fancy new airplane that's got 2 million vertices in it, you need to have this kind of data representation. So you create a float 32 array, originally starting with these numbers just to keep it simple. You could just generate the float 32 array directly in a loop and do these other fancy things. But for a simple teaching exercise, you create it out of JavaScript array data. You create one of these, and you say, the data from here is going to be stuffed into the array buffer. Which array buffer? It was this one we bound up here. All right. The net result of all this craziness is that we have a vertex buffer now with the data for a cube. Yeah, some of the vertices are the same. There's actually a technique called indexed data, where you'd only have these vertices in here uniquely once, or, you know, just the 8 vertices, right? Those are the things, you just have them in there once, and then you'd have a separate array that described the faces using indexes into this array. So if that's the right way to do it most of the time, and for a cube, that's the way you would do it, but that would introduce more arrays, more buffers, and it would just be harder to teach and get through all the concepts. So very perceptive. Better way to do this is using indexing and extra GL calls. But we'd be here all day just looking at that. And we don't have all day. So did everyone get that question? So basically, we repeated the vertex data for these, and we don't need to. There are techniques for not doing that. And as your data gets more complicated, you want to use those techniques. OK, now remember that cube is going to be moved around on the screen. We're going to use an open source library called GL Matrix, written in JavaScript by Brandon Jones. He used to be at Motorola, now he's at Google. And he's got this library called GL Matrix, and that's what MAT4 is. We're going to say create a matrix, and this matrix is going to represent the cube, pushing it 8 units away from the camera. We could also move the camera, but we're going to keep the camera at the origin for this exercise. So we're actually putting the cube 8 units back from the origin. And we're just going to keep the camera at the origin for rendering. And so we move that there, and we're also going to use model view matrix later to animate. But it starts out at the origin. Then we create this projection matrix I was talking about to get the pixels on the screen. And thankfully, there's a helper in GL matrix for that. So we want a projection matrix with a 45-degree field of view. Does anyone know what a radian is? Are you familiar with radian measures of angles, right? So 2 pi radians is 360 degrees, 2 times pi, right? So if you want 45 degrees, you divide 2 pi by 8, or in this case, pi by 4. You know, it's kind of nice in CSS if you want to do one of these rotations. You can say deg, you know, 30 deg, 30 degrees, and the browser figures it out for you. You can also say 3.14 rad if you want 180 degrees. You can say that in your CSS, but most people don't think in radians. Well, you know, we're stuck with this, and thankfully there are, you know, 3.js has degrees to radians converters and things, so if you hate thinking in radians, you don't have to. I'm used to it. 45-degree camera angle. This is the aspect ratio of this projection matrix we're going to create, the width divided by the height. And that magic is going to get those pixels projected on the screen. We're going to create this rotation axis, which we're going to use for animation. So the rotation axis here is, we're going to take 1, 1, 1, so that's positive X, positive Y out of the screen. So we've got a rotation vector like this. We're going to normalize it, which turns it into a unit vector that we can then use to multiply into our matrix, and we're going to use that to rotate the cube about it every frame. So there's some matrix math in there.
And at that point, sorry about that, Zach.
This thing's a bit hard to keep glued on to me. Lost audio, I don't know when. Is it good?
It's good, it just happened right now.
Okay, good. So at this point, we have the data for a cube. We're ready to tumble it on the screen, but we're not quite ready to render it. We have to do a few more things. So we've got to create texture maps. We use a GL method to create a texture. The actual image data is just an image element. We're doing one, you know, in code, but this could be an image element on your page. So this is, you know, normal old 2D web stuff. We're going to have an onload handler that we're going to call when the image is loaded, because we need to futz with it after it's loaded. So we need to know that. And then we set the source property, and boom, we're off to the races to go get the image data. This is just a browser loading it. It's going to call your onload function. All right? And we're going to say, you know, we don't even want to try animating, drawing, or anything until that texture is loaded, because bad things will happen. So we're going to wait. And so we call our load callback that's going to say, OK, we're OK to run. And what does that mean? Well, we had to do some stuff with this texture map. Now, back to this bind, we're saying that the GL texture we created previously is the one we're now going to populate as a 2D texture using this bind magic. So the, again, GL stuff for saying this is the current texture. All methods that are texture-oriented that are subsequent to this call, until we say this at the end, unbind it, are going to operate on the current texture. So what we're saying is WebGL's texture coordinates, the way it represents image data to be mapped onto an object, because of this y up, y down difference with 2D and 3D, they come in upside down, but WebGL will automatically flip them for us if we do this little magic here. So the 2D texture gets loaded. When we populate the bits in the texture, it will get flipped in Y for us by the engine, by the graphics card. And then we say this stuff, which says we're going to have an RGBA texture that we're going to use, and that's the texture's image data. Boom, that's how the data gets in there. We're also going to say we're going to do some filtering on these to MIP map it, basically, and we can play with that. Maybe we even have a lab to play with that. It does different filtering to make it look aliased or anti-aliased, to be smoother, basically, and we'll see that. Okay, then we say we're okay to run. So that means the texture's ready. Are we done yet? No, not done yet. Almost, though. Promise. So the white's appearing okay here, or is it still too washed out? Okay. Yeah, that red's a little bad. What this red says in a big, you know, flashing alert is, if you do not supply a GLSL set of textures, shaders, the vertex shader and the fragment shader, nothing will appear on your screen. This is the classic noob, what the hell's happening issue when you start with WebGL, which is, I wrote all my code. I don't see it. It's not drawing. I mean, and this is bad about 3D graphics. This happens all the time. If the screen's blank, you don't know what's going on. Maybe your camera's pointed that way instead of that way. Maybe your coordinates are, you know, you got to flip everything in negative with negative one. A friend of mine likes to joke, graphics programming is all about having an even number of sign errors, right? So if it doesn't work, flip one axis, right? But in this case, you're not seeing something because the code to draw the pixels on the screen has not been supplied. So you have to do this with WebGL. When we start looking at 3.js, you won't have to write this. They wrote it for you. You just say, give me, you know, a basic kind of shader that does this, and it pulls one out of its library. We'll see that next section. What is this? This is source code in the GLSL shader language. There are several ways to compose the source code up. I am doing string concatenation with the plus operator. You could take an array of these and do a join. You could put this in a separate text file and load it via AJAX. Okay, it's just a text file, right? And you could take the text content after you get the AJAX load and tell WebGL, here it is. You can also do a trick, which is you can create a script node in your page. Say it's MIME type on the script node is something that the browser doesn't know about. x-shader/x-fragment. And then use the inner text content, literally the text content that you can get out of your DOM API. Just put text right in there. So the browser won't try and interpret it as JavaScript. It will ignore the text content. And then you go on through the DOM and say, give me that elements.text content, feed it to the shader. In this case, slapping together a string. So it's kind of ugly. We got new lines at the end, right? But the end result of this, if you ignore the funk on the outside here and the outside here, is, you know, a C-like language where you're declaring attributes of vertices, you're declaring, and we'll get to that in a second, you're declaring these matrices we were talking about, right? So this is GLSL in action. We've been fed the model view matrix, which says where the cube is in space, including those rotations. We've got this projection matrix that knows how to turn that into a flat 2D vertex that's actually in screen space in your viewport now, right? So that's what happens. And those things were supplied as parameters, right? I'll tell you what uniform means in a minute. So here are the parameters to the shader. Your code's going to say, hey, here are parameters, here's your value every time you go through this run loop and the draw loop. We'll see that in a second. So those are passed in along with the vertex position, right? Where's vertex pause? Right here. All right, so for every different vertex in your mesh, this is going to be different. So this shader is being executed for every vertex in the mesh. So if you have a million meshes in your 747 model, there's a piece of hardware code that's executing this program on every vertex in real time, at least 30, maybe 60 frames a second if you're really good. Think about that for a second. So for every vertex, vertex pause is going to be different. Those are those 3D positions in space. But the model view and projection matrices are going to be the same for every vertex in here. That's why these are called uniforms and these are called attributes. And this one is an output that we're going to output for every time we're executed that's going to say where to get data out of the texture. And that's going to be used later in the fragment shader. Complicated stuff. Point is, our GL.position that's built into GLSL, we've computed a screen space position based on the inputted vertex for that particular vertex multiplied into model space because they're tumbling. This is the transform part. Projected onto the screen because it needs to get into that viewport. That 2D position is output here in GL position. And then we say, oh, and the texture coordinate that we needed to pass in, those are supplied by the application. We're saying that if you remember what this thing looks like, let's switch over to it for a second. That was it. I had it. Yeah. Right? So you see the texture map on here. That's just a bitmap, right? Well, every place on the face of this cube has to be, you know, every bit has to be pulled out of the texture. And so what we were doing there to compute the texture coordinate is based on the vertex position. So let's go back to the code again. Yeah. So the application supplied what those texture coordinates should be for a particular vertex, right? So the texture coordinate for the, if you're looking at the texture here, is going to be, you know, 0, 0. And the texture coordinate for the other side of the cube is going to be 1, 1. And everything, every pixel on the face is interpolated in between. So supplied by the application. So we now output the texture coordinate, and now the fragment shader comes along and it says, give me that texture coordinate, S and T. This is a convention in graphics. You can, I think, say X and Y. There interchangeably. It's a 2D vector, so you can access this in GLSL with different selectors or properties, if you will. So the texture coordinates, X and Y coordinate, are fed, and the sampler is actually the texture map, the image, are pulled out using this function texture2D. The graphics card literally gets the texture data out of the texture you supplied and colors the pixel with that. Now, if you want to shade this cube, if you want to mix in a base color, so you'd say, well, it's a blue cube. It's not a white cube. It's a blue cube with that WebGL texture on it. So on all, the white pixels are going to look totally blue, and the red ones are going to look purple, right? You would mix this fragment color not only with the texture, but some other supplied color as another parameter to this shader. And you can see how you imagine if you wanted to build a video game with really rich objects moving around, lots of them doing all this stuff all the time with complicated shapes and shading and all this. It's going to be a lot of work to get that done if you're working at this level. If you're a game engine hacker, you're all over it, though. But yeah, that's what you got to do. That's how the things get shown on the screen. Yeah?
So the previous slide, the shading program, is used to draw a single quad, right? That's a program that draws a single quad.
No, it draws the whole cube.
It draws the whole cube, but that's when you feed the shader with data.
You feed the shader with data, but the data is the vertices. Not the quads.
But the program itself is for drawing a single quad, right? No.
Which are you looking at? Example 2-3. It's for drawing a whole cube.
The previous slide. Sorry about the shader source. Yeah, shader source. So source itself is actually.
This will draw anything, any kind of mesh data. This is responsible for drawing every vertex in the mesh. You could draw. You could draw.
The color value from the texture. So it's actually mapping a texture to a point.
It's getting the color value out, and it's mapping the texture to a vertex position, right? Or position on a triangle. It's not really a quad. Under the covers, these are triangles, right?
But all that code just does a single pixel.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. This code does a single pixel. This code gets the vertex position in screen space. Again, so you start it in model space, you project it into world space using the, you know, model matrix, right? So that's how it moves or rotates, right? And then you use the projection matrix to get into the 2D stuff. And then you pull out a texture based on where you are based on the texture coordinate you pull out, right? And that's here, and that was passed in for each vertex, and that depends on the quad data from the application, right? Does that make sense? Yeah. So there's nothing quad specific about it at this level of the shader. You can feed it any pixel data, any vertex data, any texture, and this will draw essentially an unshaded polygon just using the texture. There's no shading on it. There's no extra colors. It's just using the texture map values. It's just a texture mapping program based on the vertex data. That's right, yeah.
But you could also use it to draw any other.
Yeah, you could. I just, in order to set that up in code and walk through it with you guys, we didn't want to do, like, you know, the data for a car model. It would take us forever. I mean, it would be like 30, 40 pages just to set the data up, right? But yes, you can use this on anything. So finally, we're actually ready to draw. What does that mean? Okay, this is going to clear the whole viewport. Geo clear color is saying the following. RGBA. What value is that? That's black with no opacity, okay? And these are floats. They're not CSS colors. This is floats from 0 to 1, all right? So RGBA of black, we're going to enable a depth test. That means pixels that are closer when they're drawn in screen space are going to obscure ones that are farther away, right? We need to do that, otherwise our cube will appear inside and out and all that. You can try it. It's pretty fun. If you just comment this line out, you see what happens. Maybe we'll do that in the lab. And then we're going to say we're going to clear the color buffer. That's what paints our viewport. And we're going to clear the depth buffer so we can do this depth test of which vertices are in front of which ones. We need to use that shader program we created previously. All we'd done so far is create something we stuff into memory. So now we're saying this is the one we're going to use to shade this object we're about to draw. Remember, GL's a state machine. The buffer we created, which seems like 3 years ago now with this walkthrough, but it was only 5 minutes ago. That buffer we created with the cube data, we're now saying this is the buffer we're going to use to draw. We are going to say, where is it? Hold on. Vertex attrib pointer. This binds the shader's position to, that's all. It's saying this is the shader position attribute. That's the vector position that got passed in. And that's based on the data in this buffer. We're also going to pass texture coordinates. Remember those text coord variables? That's in another buffer, which we filled with texture coordinate data, which I glossed over. We didn't look at it on a slide, but it's in the example 2-3. And we're going to bind that attribute. Oh, and then we're going to say, here are the indices to draw the actual cube data. Pass in the uniforms, which are the matrices we use to compute those positions in the vertex shader. We're going to activate texture 0, which we are going to now set the data from in bind texture. And we're going to say, shader sampler uniform. So there's code we don't have. You've got it in your example we didn't do. These were set up previously. It's just more GL low-level crap that says the shader attributes are being fed from JavaScript code. So we're going to, you know, we can go take a look at that. I can flash that on the screen. Actually, do that right now. Yeah, sorry, I glossed over that detail in here. Shader, what's it called? Shader projection matrix uniform. Right. So more GL low-level machination that says, in the shader program, which I asked you to compile, the strings I concatenated up that we looked at, find the variable declared in there called projection matrix. Create something at the JavaScript level that I can feed with data. So now this is the JavaScript variable that I used in that call I just showed you. We'll go back and look in a second. So you have to set up uniforms separately, yeah. So there probably should be two more pages on the slide for all this other setup junk, and there it is. So there's a lot to this. So again, we go back and we use that. So this gets fed the matrix values we use in the vertex shader. Same here, the sampler, this is the texture. It's called a sampler in GL speak. Set that up. Deep breath. Draw the cube. So passing it in some stuff we saved away. It's a primitive type. We've got a GL enumeration for that. It's in the code somewhere. I forgot what it's called. How many indices are we using? That's set up somewhere. The indices required to draw a cube. They're represented as 8-bit short data. I mean 16-bit, sorry, short data. And that draws the cube. And we do this as many times a second as we can using request animation frame. And the cube is on the screen. And just to remind everyone, because it does seem like hours ago at this point, this is how it happens. After all that setup, we say run. Run calls that draw function we just looked at. Animate. Do we have animate on the next slide? Nope. Animate mutates this a little bit every frame, so it rotates. Let me pull that up. So we're just basically using a date function to figure out how many milliseconds have passed since last time. Everybody comfortable with date.now, timing functions? All right, this gives a number of milliseconds. We're saying we got a 5-second tumble animation, so we're going to use that to divide into what our current delta time is from when we started, or actually from the previous time. And then we're going to use that delta time to create this fractional value. So it's not milliseconds, it's in seconds. And we're going to use that to just tweak the angle a little bit every frame. And we use that angular value and feed it to mat4. So this is GL matrix, that open source library that does matrix math. We feed it to a rotate function, and it just rotates about an axis we gave it earlier. Remember we created a rotation axis facing that way and normalized it? Rotate by that angle. Magic, math. Taking those matrices and multiplying vectors by them, puts it into that model view matrix, which was declared as a shader uniform in the shader program, which we, you know, by putting it in here, that thing is bound at the draw time. Remember we set up the uniform. That's how the data magically gets all the way from JavaScript down into the hardware as a matrix used to compute every vertex position, every frame.
So does it do any clipping? Like, does what GL know not to, it figures out what not to render? Like,
so the depth test bit that we set at the top of the function,
yeah.
What that does is says, I know at this point, before I've done my projection, you know, when I'm calling the vertex shader, you know, I know which things are going to get clipped. And I'm only going to ask you to shade vertices that are getting clipped because of depth. It's in the hardware, it's basically saying this one's going to be in front of that one. I'm going to throw out the stuff that would be behind it. So you don't have to draw anything that's not going to appear on the screen.
So will it run the vertex shader but not the other one?
That's a good question. I'm thinking it's got to run the vertex shader because it won't know what's clipped until you've shaded, you know, you've run the vertex shader.
Yeah, that's what right. I'm wondering if, like,
so it probably doesn't call the fragment shader.
Yeah.
That's got to be the way it works because it won't know the 2D screen space vertex position until you've run the shader. And at that point, it can say, you know, depth test on the stuff.
So
right.
You'd want to, like, remove maybe elements from the screen that you know aren't going to run.
Well, that's a separate question. If you think they're not going to show up in the viewport,
yeah.
You do that in software. You basically,
yeah.
So that viewport represents a truncated pyramid volume in a perspective projection, right? Because the front face is smaller than the back face. You've got, you know, a frustrum, what they call it. You can find out if objects, a box, bounding box of the objects in the frustrum. If it's not, you don't even try and compute it. You don't try and draw. You don't try and shade it. Good engines do that kind of stuff. 3.js does that for us. All right, we did it. We got through this. So before we start in the lab, I think I just have to make a few comments here. I've made no secret of the fact that I don't think this API is for mere mortals. I think if you are trying to do a project on web development time, this is not a good way to go. If you want to build a game engine that runs in a web browser and does some really kick-ass stuff, you may want to invest your time and energy into learning the API at this level. If you're doing very specific high-performance data visualization of something, and you know you're only drawing certain kinds of shapes, you can write code on top of this, make your own framework that draws those kind of shapes really efficiently, really beautifully, write your own custom shaders that does all, you know, takes time series data and other stuff as input, makes things glow, animate, and do all this very specific drawing. If, however, you want to use 3D production data to do a visualization of a product, or do any of many kind of web application, you want to build a simple game and you don't want to build your own engine, you're more than likely not going to program at this level. You're going to use somebody else's engine. We're going to talk about that for the rest of the day. And only revisit this if it's relevant, say, to create a custom shader that you can use in 3.js, because you can do that. And you can start with stuff out of the box and then customize. And at that point, knowing GLSL is real helpful. Okay. But beyond that, I would say for most of us, we're going to use a toolkit, and we're going to do that. I got some lab stuff we can try and do now. You guys got the sources. Let's start with this. And this is just a way to keep us all engaged and alive here. We're not going to come out of this doing like 10 hours of programming today. There's just no time. We've got too much material to cover. But if you guys want to do this, I'll give you 5 minutes on this one. So again, the window background, let's make it red instead of black. Done yet? Kidding, but give me a couple minutes. In time, let me go find that. I've got some solutions. There's not always one answer to these, by the way. This one's got a pretty straightforward answer, though.
Sorry.
Yeah.
I actually have problem downloading stuff.
Someone got the thumb drive? We've got somebody who's got it on SneakerNet now. Yeah, great. I'll be ready to pop that open in a moment. Yeah. We can take a break. Let's get through this and then we'll take a break. That was, someone asked if we have a break time schedule. I don't know if there's any, is there any coffee or anything set up for, do we know? Yeah, so. But we can give you guys a 10-minute break for a leg stretch and whatever else. But let's get through the labs. Everyone done?
Yeah.
Anybody having an issue with it or a question? Okay, who wants to volunteer the answer? That's right. Hint number one, it's RGB. It's not CSS colors. It's not, you know, it's not a hex value. It's not a string. It's a number in the range of 0 to 1. What's that?
Clear color
1, what?
100.
There's four elements to it. It's RGBA. Clear color 1001 is the correct answer. If you go into the, there's a labs folder under the sources here. Which has the solutions to each one. Don't cheat, but I'm saying later if you want to go back and look. And you can just search for that, lab colon. And I threw in a comment, hopefully helpful, not deceptive one. And it is GL clear color 1001. You are correct. Very good. Let's do the extra credit version of this. Let's do it with a transparent background. And you know what, maybe since it's a white cube, if you make it a transparent background against a white page, it might not look so good. Maybe change the page background color too.
I have a question.
Yeah. Alpha. Well, it's what we're doing right now, right? Yes, what's the A element? That is the background alpha. You know, in your pages, you can have a background on your page that's transparent, right? And you use the alpha to do that. You can do that in CSS. In fact, because the web browser composites everything, you can have your WebGL canvas element styled with CSS, specify the alpha in the CSS, and not even have to do this nonsense. And the bits will be transparent. And your 3D object can float on your page. And that's pretty sweet. Everyone get that? So, I mean, we already sort of gave the answer away. So now, we're doing a full zero clear. Alpha zero, fully transparent background. Again, that's going to look a little better if you got a different page background color. Let's see what I did for mine. All right, there it is. So now imagine you can do a quick test of this, throw some lorem ipsum in there or something, you know, throw a bunch of text in there, and this thing's going to appear floating on top of it. You can even do fun stuff like fake drop shadows, or try to do real-time shadows, and then you got 3D shadowed objects floating on top of 2D presentation of text. Hella cool. We have more labs? Yeah. Next one is about this matrix math. Instead of the 45-degree field of view on our camera projection, let's make it 60 degrees. Remember, we're thinking in radians, too. There's your hint. Math. More math than you ever wanted to deal with. But you don't get the pretty pictures unless you do the math. Anyone got that yet? You're on it, man. You're right on top of this. Anyone having serious trouble or just trying to figure it out? Good. How we doing? What? It's okay. Instead of a 45-degree field of view in the perspective projection, let's do a 60-degree field of view. Got to think in radians. Second hint, 2 pi radians equals 360 degrees. Pi radians equals 180. Everyone good? Close enough? Here we go. And then look at the result. All right, here we go. 2. Mapped out pi over 3. 180 degrees divided by 3, 60 degrees. See what it looks like? This is one of the interesting things. Here's our original example. Look at that. It's the same cube. It looks farther away, but all we've really done is we made a wider angle camera lens. So that's how it's going to show up. Cube didn't move in space. Camera didn't move in space, but now we're seeing a bigger scene because we have this essentially horizontal field of view that's bigger. So That's how you can do a camera zoom effect. Just change the field of view, like, and you can just update that field of view every frame, like based on a slider or something, and do some really cool camera effects. You can do it based on animation data and do some crazy cool stuff. Yeah. But yeah, this is zooming a this is changing a perspective projection. So you'll not only zoom in on an object, but if you're in a scene, you'll see more stuff based on a wider angle or less based on a tighter angle. Yeah, and that's why we do these things. It's not just to torture ourselves with mathematics, but to start thinking about how to create visual effects, right? Great question. Okay. Here we go. We're going to write some shader code now, or hack some shader code. Sweet. So in the GLSL shader, we're going to reverse the direction of the texture map in horizontal direction. Not this flip Y thing I was talking about earlier, which happens automatically based on that flag. We're going to write shader code to make the texture map appear backwards relative to the surface of each face of the cube. Did something? Let's see. Yeah, it's backwards. Let me see how he did it. That's it. It looks weird, doesn't it? It's going to look weird. You're not going to know if you really did it right. Maybe make the animation stop, and then you can look at it and see better. But what'd you do? Let's see.
Negative on the dot S.
Yeah. I have a slide. This is one of those ones with multiple answers. We're going to talk about that because I didn't really dive into every detail, but that's a good, it works. It does. Did you do it the same way?
Yeah.
That's it. It'd be interesting to see if people come up with the other answer, which is my official answer to this. But it also relies on information maybe I didn't tell you, so maybe that's not fair. Anybody struggling with that one needs to know where to look? Everyone know you need to go look at the code that's using the vtext coord components and do something with it. Because what we're doing is we're getting pixels out of the texture map based on those XY text, you know, the S and T components of the texture coordinate for each vertex.
What's the abbreviation for
T? What do you mean? What does it mean? S and T is a graphics convention for defining the horizontal and vertical coordinates in a texture. Think of them as X and Y. They're just the X and Y component of a 2D texture. S and T by convention are used for these variables because U and V are used to talk about texture coordinates in general. So it's just a set of graphics convention, right? You get X, Y, and Z for your vertex stuff. They use U and V. And you get W in your matrix, so that was already used. So they use U and V to talk about texture coordinates, and then S and T to talk about the pixels that they correspond to inside the texture map's data itself, right? So the texture coordinates are U and V elements that are with each vertex. You're saying, this vertex has a UV position that maps into the texture. I'm going to pull that out based on this texture coordinates, S and T. Just convention. Doesn't stand for, you know, Sam and Tom or something. It's a mathematical variable. So has everybody sort of figured this out? There's actually two answers to this. I'm going to give mine first, and then these guys up here both simultaneously came up with, and separately, a different version of the answer. So texture coordinates are actually range in a coordinate space from 0 to 1. So the proper way to flip these texture coordinates, so right, this is a value from 0 to 1 for the horizontal component of the texture, right? So by subtracting 1 from it, you get its inverse, and it comes out backwards. However, these enterprising gentlemen figured out another way to do it. I wasn't sure that would work until I saw it in action. And that is what?
Just made the vtext coordinates negative.
That's right. Put a minus sign in front of the vtext coord.s. Now what you're getting is instead of a value from 0 to 1, you're getting a value from 0 to negative 1. Apparently WebGL was smart enough to figure out how to wrap that texture in space. So, you know, basically these are a coordinate system from 0 to 1 no matter what. If you're outside that range, the hardware will do the right thing and map it. Now, that may not, you know, I don't even know if that works in every graphics driver. It may puke. Or this may just work as part of the WebGL spec, and I'd have to dig into the details to see. So the more technically correct and robust way to do that, I believe, is this. But that was a very good first hack, and you guys were operating without all the information, so bravo.
Swapping the S and the T works also.
That's going to do something different.
Yeah,
that's going to do something really different, I would think. That's going to rotate it up. It's going to flip them both. Yeah, what's it going to look like? Let's see. So let me do this one that we were just looking at. No. What was it? There. So, looks a little bizarre. If you stop it from animating, though, you'll see that that's just backwards horizontally. It kind of looks upside down because your eye's getting tricked a little bit. So, does it look just that way when you swap S and T as well?
Yeah.
That's a coincidence. I don't think it would work for every texture and every setup, but maybe because it's a cube. Yeah. Yeah, take the animation away, look at it. There's no way to interact with this unless you want to write a zillion more lines of code. You can't, like, rotate the cube around with your mouse as much as you're tempted to do that. We'll get into that later and how you do it. So, guys, great time for a break.